Okay, let's pray.
Father, we just we come before you, Father, and there's many requests and many praises, Lord God. And Lord God, I pray, Lord God, for Lucky's family, Lord. And I pray for our district. I pray for our pastor, Lord God, that things are need to be taken care of. And I pray, Lord God, that your hand would be upon each person, Lord God, that has to deal with those things that Lucky leaves behind, because my understanding, he was a go-getter. He got things done. When it needed to be done, he could do it. And he was a person that they talked to. So I just ask, Lord God, that you would be with each person. I pray for all these requests, Lord. I ask, Lord, that you would grant these requests, Lord God, of healing and of things that need to be taken care of, Father. I have a request, too. It's been a difficult week. Sometimes things seem to overpower us, power me. So pray for me too, okay? Anyway, Lord, just continue to bless the people like you are, Lord. I do thank you, Lord God, for your answered prayer, Lord God. I praise you for those things. I think of Irene right now, Lord God, and I ask, Lord, that you would be with her son and that you would touch him. I would pray, Lord God, that your spirit would work on him, Lord God, and that he would come to know you as his Lord and Savior. Lord, I thank you for the praise report that Greg and Jan were okay. I thank you for Desi, Lord. I thank you for her faithfulness and her desire to serve you. I thank you, Lord God, for the healing that has taken place in her body. And I thank you, Lord God, for the healing that is going to take place, Lord. Comfort her anxiety, Lord God. Mm-hmm. Don't let that take a hold of her, Lord God. I would ask that you would remove that out of her, Lord God.
Thank you, God.
I think about the people that Esther was talking about with all the stuff that is going on there, Lord. I would pray, Lord, that your hand would be up on them. The children that are there, the young boy, Lord God. But thank you for my brother, Doug, that he's okay. That he's just sore. Lord, let this service bring glory and honor to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood. service for Jesus, your King. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Praise the Lord. Praise you, Lord.
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He led and died to buy my pardon, an empty grave. Savior lives, because He lives, I can face tomorrow, because He lives, all fear is gone, because I know He holds a future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days, because Christ lives, because He lives, I can face tomorrow, because He lives, all fear is gone. Because He lives, and then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain, and then as death gives way to happiness. Come on, ring those bells like the Celebrations come because of something good. Celebrations we love to recall. Mary had a baby born in Bethlehem, the greatest celebration of them all. Come on, ring those bells, light the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King. Come on, ring those bells like the Christmas tree. Jesus is the King, born for you and me. Come on, ring those bells, everybody say. Jesus, we remember this your birthday.
Have you guessed it? We're kind of in that Advent season time of the year. You may not be a musician, and if you are, you'll understand this. Christmas songs are probably the hardest to play. So you're going to get a dose of ones that I can play, and then they may be, get repeated before this season is over, because I don't know that many. So we're going to do some easy ones for you, hopefully.
Star of Bethlehem. look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art.
Sent your son in the form of a babe to that lowly manger in Bethlehem to set an example for us, an example of service, humility, and servitude, an example that we should live out in our lives, that the greatest among us must be the servant of all. And so, Lord, we think of your greatness and how you displayed that. We thank, Lord, today how you continue as though you created it all and yet you serve us. And it's just, it's unbelievable. Your great love for us, your availability to us in our times of need, your provision for us, your compassion for us. God, it goes beyond our ability to understand. But Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We are humbled before your throne this morning, God. Lord, we think of this day, this first day of Advent, as a day of hope, when prophecies of a coming Messiah, a coming Savior, are celebrated. And we thank you, Lord, this morning that there is still hope. That God, for the lost around the world, those who are have not yet accepted you, and even for we who have, Lord, there is hope beyond the grave. There is hope beyond this world. Lord, so many are suffering through this pandemic and even other things going on with the loss of loved ones. And Lord, as we come and we've celebrated Thanksgiving and our hearts are full of joy as we head toward the Christmas holidays, I know, Lord, that during the holidays there are those who are weeping, who are in a time of mourning, a time of loss, a time when they are wondering if there will ever be a day of celebration. And so, Lord, we hold them up before your throne even now. We ask, Lord, that you would bring them comfort, a sense of your presence, and a renewal of that sense of a hope beyond the grave. Lord, we look at the condition of our world. Many have given up and say there is no hope. But God, there is. There is hope through you. So we thank you for that. Lord, whether it be in this continent or where it is around the world, we thank you that as people turn their hearts and their lives toward you, redemption, renewal, and a sense of hope takes place of a sense of despair. And so, Lord, we celebrate that together this morning. We celebrate you, the hope that only you can bring, the hope of this season, the hope of Christ among us. And we worship and praise your name together. In his name, Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. The ushers are coming. We'll receive this morning's tithes and offerings. Amen. Thank you, Kim. She's always trying to stump me with titles of music and stuff. She would have gotten me this morning, but somebody alerted me, I think. old Christmas carol there. Well, I hope you had an amazing Thanksgiving week. Everybody do all right, except the turkeys? Yeah. So, yeah, if you were a turkey, it was a bad week. So, I want to tell you, this first Sunday of Advent, really, we're going to have a message of hope, okay, this morning. And then next week, I'm going to start into a brand new series, God with us, Emmanuel. Just as the wise men came to worship Jesus, I want us this Christmas season just to kind of, from this point on toward Christmas, turn our hearts toward Christ. And in doing so, we're going to look at four places where we find ourselves in life where we might wonder, where is God? Where is God? And I want you to have the assurance, God never leaves us. He is always by our side. And so we're going to learn that God is with us in the valley, that God is with us in the wilderness, that God stays with us in the storms of life, and that He is always with us. And so I can't wait to share with you what God has put on my heart there, and that's going to start next week. But I just want to welcome you here today, those of you who are here in the sanctuary, and those of you who are online with us today, and it's always a pleasure to have you smiling back as I preach, so I don't have to preach to myself, and so I'm happy to have you here, and many who join us online, actually from all around the world. It's kind of amazing as we get the reports back on that. I don't know about you, but for me, as we move into this busy season, during the holidays, there are so many distractions, so many things that can catch our attention and really distract us. And I think the distractions take us away from the goodness of the season that God has intended for us, or they can. And so these messages in the upcoming weeks are specifically designed to keep our hearts centered on the incarnate Christ as we celebrate this season. So I hope you make it a commitment in your heart and priority for you and your family to be either here or online, each week as we go through this, and just to keep our hearts centered on a real reason for the season. And the real reason for the season is Jesus Christ, Him crucified and resurrected. Okay? So, and I'll guarantee you, if you'll do that, I think, it can really make the holidays special for you and just so much better as we learn that Christ is still with us, okay? So today, though, I want you to hear the story of a biblical character from the Old Testament named Mephibosheth. You might be like, Mephibahu, is pastor making up stuff this morning or whatever? What's he doing? So let me tell you, it's a really great story. It really is. Many of you, even if you've come to church and sometimes you think to yourself, hey, I'm getting a little insecure. You may feel like you don't know the Bible stories as well as the person next to you. Maybe if you don't come to church, you might all the time, you didn't grow up in church. Well, what's going on here? But you don't have to feel that way today, because there are many who have come to church all their lives that don't really understand or know of the story of Mephibosheth, okay? It's an unlikely one. And I haven't heard a lot of messages about Mephibosheth, okay? So just not taught on, but it's a beautiful, beautiful truth and a message of hope for this first day of Advent. But before we get there, I want to see just by a show of hands, here and online. I can see you online, you know that, don't you? So And you have to participate, right? Okay, everybody's got to participate to make this fun. So how many of you would say, you know what, in my life, there are just a lot of times that unlikely events happen to me? Anybody? Okay. Some of you haven't lived much. Okay. But in my life, there's just a lot of unlikely events that have happened to me. Now, I have a theory. If you have children, unlikely events have happened to you. It just has. I mean, they just... It's going to happen, you know, and I think it increases about tenfold with each child you have. So we raised two, which meant at least every hour that something unlikely was going to happen, you know. So something really bizarre, usually, you know, and you have kids. Ours were opposites, you see, just a case in point. They were totally different. One was a cop, the other was a free but stubborn spirit. Okay, just totally different. And the cop made everyone else live by the rules except himself, okay? And especially when it came to the free but stubborn spirit of his younger sister. Now, that's just the way it was. So, anyway, he was always tattling on others, especially his sister. So one day, Esther hears the command of a policeman, you know, coming down the hallway, and this was kind of his normal command at announcement at this age in his life, and he was yelling. He couldn't quite pronounce his sister's name at this time. L's were really tough at this point in the game. So he said, instead of Julie, you know, he's, "Mommy, Julie's in trouble. Julie's in trouble," you know. And so Esther knew, you know, the voice of the cop, she has to go investigate. So fulfill the law enforcement voice, you know. So she heads toward the bathroom where our son is sitting on the toilet doing his business, and our daughter is fishing out his creations. Yes. I mean, completely bizarre things. You just never know what's going to happen. Sometimes unlikely events happen in our lives, and especially if there are children involved. So, anyway, that was an event neither one of us could ever have imagined happening. Well, I better get back on track here. We're going to talk about a young child and an unlikely event this morning, because today we're going to encounter just an unlikely, a beautiful truth from a biblical character named Mephibosheth, whose story starts in 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. So if you have your Bibles, you can turn to 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. And the Bible says this: Saul's son, Jonathan, had a son named Mephibosheth, who was crippled as a child. He was 5 years old when the report came from Jezreel that Saul and Jonathan had been killed in battle. Just pause in the scripture there for a second. Very important to understand the power of this story, and to get the power of this story in context, you have to know the characters involved in the story. So we're gonna go back here. We're gonna just take a look at this. First thing we have is, in this story, there is King Saul. Okay, so Saul is king of Israel, obviously, current king, King Saul. Now, he has a son. The king's son is Jonathan. And it's important to know that. Saul, the king, son, Jonathan. Now, Saul also has a grandson by Jonathan, and Saul's grandson and Jonathan's son is named Mephibosheth. Okay? So, and then we also have another guy outside the family, and that guy happens to be David. This is the David who's going to succeed Saul as king. This is David who you know, slew Goliath. This is the guy who kills the giant, that David. So these are the characters in this unlikely story. Imagine Mephibosheth, 5 years, he's about 5 years old, and just out playing in the courtyard, just having a fun day. I don't know what royal kids do. I've never been one. So, but he's out there eating grasshoppers or whatever they do. Yeah, probably not. But just hanging out, having a good time, and the palace doors burst open. People just absolutely go into pandemonium, screaming, hollering, and yelling, and the kids going like, what's going on? You know, he's just a little five-year-old. What's happening here? And they say, your dad and your granddad have been killed in battle. They're dead. Well, that's a bad start to the day for a five-year-old kid. For anybody, even if you're not 5 years old. But it gets worse. You see, they're in a panic. You see, David is on his way to the palace to assume power. Now, that would have been a problem in this monarchy, because at any time in a monarchy, you know, at that time, if the family lines change, what became of the old family line? Because you sure don't want a potential heir to the throne hanging around, being alive. So everybody's freaking out in the palace, thinking they're going to get killed, including Mephibosheth. Why? Well, his dad was killed. His grandfather's dead. He's next in line. Therefore, he has to be number one to go, right? Okay, so Mephibosheth there, 5 years old, Grandpa and Dad are both dead, and well, David's headed this way. Now understand the context, this five-year-old kid. David was iconic. Chronologically speaking, when this occurred in Scripture, David had already killed Goliath. In fact, David had so many escapades. He was one of Saul's top generals and had gone out and slain many a Philistine for Saul. In fact, yeah, I remind you of that old scripture that said, you know, hey, Saul killed, you know, thousands. David's killed tens of thousands. He was iconic. He was a hero of Israel. And so David and Jonathan, characters in the story, they're also really good friends. Therefore, it's almost as if David could have been like this, as Mephibosheth was growing up. You know, maybe as Dad Jonathan told him stories, David became a hero to Mephibosheth. In modern day times, he may have even, you know, had a poster of David on his wall. And David, because of his relationship with Jonathan, he could have been like a family friend of Mephibosheth. I mean, it's almost like an honorary uncle. So Mephibosheth is understanding, man, my dad's dead, killed in battle, grandpa's dead, and now David, well, he's going to be, David's coming. They're saying, well, things have changed, buddy. He's not coming to bring you a new toy for Christmas. Yeah, you know, he's coming. You're going to die. Well, what do you mean? I don't understand. It's a lot for a kid to try to take in. It's a lot for anybody to try to take in. And all of a sudden, there's this panic at the palace. Well, in the panic, Mephibosheth's nurse picks him up, begins to run. As they continue in verse 4, she drops him and breaks both his legs, and he becomes crippled. years old. They pick him up. They don't have time to make a splint. They don't have time to do anything. They just run with him to a place called Lodibar. Talk about that in a little bit. His dad passes. Grandpa passes. David, who he thought he could trust, is now going to try to come and kill him. He gets both legs broke, and they pick him up. They whisk him away. His whole world at five is flipped upside down. Hey, you ever had a Mephibosheth moment in your life? You're sitting there. Everything seems to be going just fine. You're hanging out at the palace. Everything's good. And then all of a sudden, a doctor gives you a report you did not expect. One day you felt healthy. The next day, everything's upside down, turned on its end. Maybe it's someone who you thought you could trust, and you get a report and they violated your trust. Maybe it's a relationship you thought would go for your life, and it's crumbled down around you and put your whole world on end. And in that emotion, you begin to understand where Mephibosheth finds himself in this story. For him, years go by, nothing happens. He doesn't get healed. He doesn't get helped. He's just broken. That's the story of little Mephibosheth. One day, the Bible says in 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1, one day, the Bible says, King David asked, hey people, is there anyone left in the household of David to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? Now, based off that, off what we know about killing off a monarchy, that's a really, really weird statement, right? Unless you understand the context. You see, as we talked about, Jonathan and David, they were very, very good friends. And back in the 20th chapter of 1 Samuel, what had happened was David had been anointed by Samuel to become the king of Israel. Now, Jonathan, he knew that. He was aware. The anointing was that David would be king, and Jonathan believed it, and therefore he talked to David and he said, hey, David, buddy, I know how these things work. And when you become king, would you show kindness to me and my family? Because remember, it wouldn't be a good thing for Jonathan if the royal line changes. I mean, no, that's not a good thing for Jonathan. He said, would you show kindness to me and my family? And David said, as surely as the Lord lives, I will show kindness to you and your family. Now, he had made this promise. He had made this covenant with Jonathan that he would do this. And the Bible records in 2 Samuel chapter 9 that one day, I don't know why, maybe it was a time of year when he was remembering the death of his friend Jonathan. Maybe that's what it was. I don't know. Maybe it's that, you know, hanging out and doing something that he and Jonathan loved to do together, and it just brought the memory back. And for whatever reason, it brings it to mind for David, this promise, this covenant, this love for his dear friend he has lost. And he says, hey, is there anyone left who I can show kindness to for Jonathan's sake? And they summoned this guy named Ziba. He was one of Saul's servants, okay? So they ask him this question. And this question that David had asked, and as Ziba replies, he says, there is still one son of Jonathan. He's alive, but he's crippled in both feet. Why would he do this? You see, at this time in history, this time in culture, to be have both of your legs broken, I mean, you have to understand, there were no ADA compliances. There are no handicap ramps. There are no wheelchairs. There are no attorneys to sue because you can't get someplace on your own. There's nothing for him. So this society would in many ways just push him aside and just consider him to be a burden on society and just really worthless. Now, in our point today, in our culture, we understand that that's absolutely absurd and quite ridiculous because we know that any physical limitation placed upon us has no bearing on God's ability to work through us. And in fact, many times, He works through us in a greater sense through our disabilities. We think immediately of people like Joni Erickson Tada, Nick Vujicic, you know, people like that. We understand that that's just absurd, but in the context of this story, it's just important to notice how quickly Ziba just casts him aside. Yeah, there's a kid, but he's crippled in both legs. You don't want to mess with him. Now that, though, is not the response that David gives. He says, well, where is this kid? Ziba replies, well, you know, he's out at, he's out at Lodibar. So, yeah, he's at the house of Machir. That's where he is. And David says, well, go get him. So, Lodibar. Well, Lodibar, you see, that means a place of no bread. It was considered an arid, dry, desolate place. A place way out there. Okay? You could almost say that Mephibosheth had been placed in the witness protection program. Okay? Because they wanted to kill him. So they pick him up. They take him to this place, distant place. Place of no bread. In fact, 1 Chronicles chapter 8, it's important to note that the genealogy of King Saul, Mephibosheth, is not his real name. He's in WITSEC, see? He's in witness protection. His given name is actually Meribah. Now, Meribah, that translates to opponent of Baal. Okay? He had a really good name, opponent of Baal, false gods. You know, Jonathan named his son saying, you are of royal lineage. You're an opponent of false gods. You are stately. You are royal. You are my son, Meribah. But his name got changed. Mephibosheth. What does Mephibosheth mean? Son of shame. A shameful thing. Can you imagine? 5 years old. 5 years old. You lose your dad. You lose your grandpa. Your legs are broken. Those whom you thought you could trust, you can't. You're taken away from a palace. You're left in some place called Lodibar, and they change your name from an opponent of Baal to shameful. Oh, man. So Mephibosheth, he has lived many, many years out in Lodibar. I don't know how many years. Bible really isn't clear on this. We do know that he's a grown man at this point. But he's out there, and Ziba comes. Hey, it's Ziba. Yeah? I'm here from the palace. Yeah? David wants to see you. Now, for Mephibosheth, is that a good day? See, it's like, I'm from the IRS and I'm here to help you. Okay, hello, yeah, all right. You know, it's like they're coming through the door with the big, you know, SWAT team. Well, here we are. Yeah. Oh, man, I've really been looking forward to this moment. No, I don't think so. Yeah, so it's like the incarnation of fear and worry and terror that had haunted him for years, and it had now come right to his door because he has grown up hating David because it's David's fault. I'm here in this desolate place. It's David's fault that I'm a fugitive. It's David's fault that my legs got broken. It's David, and now he wants me dead. I knew this day was coming. They've been telling me it's been coming for years, and now the time is here. Had to be how he felt. But this is where the story takes an unlikely turn. We see David's response to be quite different than Mephibosheth had been told and thought it might be. Pick up in verse 7 of 2 Samuel chapter 9, where the Bible says, "Don't be afraid." And David tells him, Don't be afraid. Because Mephibosheth had been brought before him. He says, "Don't be afraid. I intend to show you kindness because of my promise to your father Jonathan. I will give you all of the property that once belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will eat here with me at the king's table." Wow. And Mephibosheth bowed respectfully. Exclaimed, "Who is your servant that you should show such kindness to a dead dog like me?" What a terrible thing to say about yourself. I'm a dead dog. But then we can almost understand why. All of these years of hiding had made Mephibosheth think of himself as worthless. Have you ever been at a place where you just felt like you were worthless? Or maybe you weren't worthy of something? Maybe you felt inadequate for the task placed before you? You see, for Mephibosheth, in this moment, as he's receiving a blessing from King David, everything that he'd believed, everything he had known, everything he'd internalized about David had been wrong. He had to be confused. Mind just has to be spinning. What is going on here? Everything that he thought, that he knew David stood for, everything that he knew David, it was wrong. And in the same way, many of us find ourselves pushing ourselves spiritually out into our own Lodibar, a desolate place spiritually, where we begin to believe and internalize these things we think about God, or someone has told us about God. And we think, "Oh, God's mad at me because, well, I've been doing, you know, what I know I probably should be doing. I haven't been doing enough for him. Or I'm doing things that I shouldn't be doing. Or you know what? God's mad at me, and I know he's upset, and he's just waiting to drop the hammer on my head. He just waiting, and I know God's coming for me, you know. And maybe it's just that you've carried guilt for years or something that wasn't even your fault. But for some reason, you carry this guilt, and you think God is upset or angry in some way at you. I'm here to tell you today, that's just patently false. That is wrong. You see, in the same way that David had an unlikely and different outcome for Mephibosheth, God's desire, it says in His Word, is to bless you and to bring you a hope and a future. Now, it's important to know then, at this point, David says to Ziba, Ziba, come here. I'm going to give Mephibosheth, your master's grandson, I'm going to give him all of his land. And so you think about that, all of his land. I don't know how much, the kingdom size at Saul's reign, So think about this. He gives Mephibosheth all of King Saul's land. So it's not a little garden plot out beside his house, something over there in the corner. He gives him everything that had belonged to his grandfather who was king, and therefore he gets a vast amount of property. And then David says to Ziba something that he says, oh, and you and your household, all 35 of you and your servants, you are actually now going to be servants of Mephibosheth. And so they serve Mephibosheth. And then I love this, in verse 11, the Bible says, from that time on, Mephibosheth ate regularly at the king's table like one of the king's own sons. How about that? This kid from the age of 5 had all of these terrible things happen to him all of these years. All of a sudden, it just gets flipped on end, and like this beautiful story of restoration and David bringing him to a place of honor and a place of power. Oh, we love the ending of this story. We love it when we see someone who really didn't deserve that, and they really got a hard deal that they didn't deserve, and all of a sudden they end up getting restored, and it's almost like vindicated. And we go, yes, And we just stand up and shout. We just got fired up. We love seeing things like that when somebody who never got a chance, but yet they had a great voice, and they jump up on stage and they sing before a few judges and they get some great compliments, and the next thing you know, they win something and they're this star pop singer or whatever. And, we step back, we kind of high-five each other, whoo, did you see that? Oh, they're so good, right? And we cheer them on, we love the underdog. And then maybe, we love it, tragedy strikes somewhere, and you see a family, they lose their father, and all of a sudden mom's doing everything she can to keep things together, and the house starts to fall down around them, and it's in disrepair, and they don't have money, and these people, they all swoop in, and they just create a castle out of this house that's falling apart, and then they stand out in the street, and they say, move that bus, and people start crying in the street, like, oh, wow, and you're home crying on the couch. Why? Because we love stories of mercy and redemption. We love it. This is the story of Mephibosheth, this little boy who had this very terrible beginning, yet ends up with a beautiful ending. It's a story. The reason you love it is it's a story that's etched on the very DNA of your soul. Because you have to understand, we are Mephibosheth. You see, the story of Mephibosheth is a true story from the Old Testament, but it's also an allegory of what Christ has done for you and for me. What do you mean I'm Mephibosheth? Well, if you've been listening or taking notes or anything, this is important. I might even write this down. I just want to fire through this. Here's how we're Mephibosheth. We are all fallen and broken. Romans chapter 3 tells us that all of us have sinned and we fall short of God's standard. And in the same way that Mephibosheth had fallen and was broken, we have fallen and are broken. And second, you know, the great thing about this story is Mephibosheth just wasn't left there. Just like Mephibosheth, we are pursued by the king. Wow. We're pursued by the king. I mean, just not a king here on earth that can grant us some land or some kind of wealth or material possessions. That's not what it's about. We are pursued by the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We are pursued by Jesus Christ. In John chapter 3, verse 17, the Bible says, God didn't send His Son into the world to condemn the world. He's not coming here to wipe you out. No. That's not what it says at all. God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world. He sent His Son to save the world through Him. An unlikely twist to the story. Yes, the same truth that was true for Mephibosheth is true for us today. As Mephibosheth was pursued by King David, we have been pursued by the King of Kings, and not to wipe us out, to restore. So we're fallen, we're broken, we're pursued by the King. And then the last thing is that I want us to know, and we're going to celebrate this morning. The King's table covers our sin. The King's table covers our sin. I explain it this way. Perhaps last week at Thanksgiving, or you sat at a table with your family. Maybe for you, it's at Christmas dinner, you sit down at a nice table. I don't know, whatever event it is. We sit at the table with family and friends and different people. And when Mephibosheth, remember verse 11, it says that he ate regularly at the table of the king, like one of the king's own sons. He sat at the king's table. It's important for us to know that when he sat there, the crippled, broken condition of his legs were covered by the king's table. And when people looked at Mephibosheth, they didn't see a broken young man. They saw someone who was of power, of position, who had been granted access by the king. They saw someone who sat there like one of the king's own sons. In the same way, the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross and His blood that was shed for us covers our spiritually broken condition, and we are made whole and complete at the King's table because the sacrifice of Jesus Christ covers our sin. As the same way that table covered Mephibosheth's broken condition. Except for us, through the blood of Jesus Christ and the covering of His table, we are made whole. We are made complete. Underneath the covering of the power of Jesus' sacrifice and forgiveness, our sins are destroyed. You no longer see our sins. And we are made like one of the King's own sons. You see, you may think you are broken and useless, but God says you are chosen. You are invited to His table. He says, I now grant you to the right to eat and drink at my table in my kingdom. Verse 13 in 2 Samuel 9 says, Mephibosheth, who was crippled in both feet, lived in Jerusalem and ate regularly at the king's table. We, knowing that we are Mephibosheth, you just put your name in there, whatever, who were broken, now eats regularly at the king's, the Lord's table. Because you see, we're fallen, we're broken, but we're pursued by the king, and the king's table, it covers our sin. And even though we may think that we are broken and useless, oh no, oh no. God says we are chosen and invited, and that is something to be thankful for. Amen. I'm going to ask the guys to come. They're going to distribute the elements as we listen to some music together.
Come at the Lord's invitation. hang on to the cups for just a moment. Let's pray together, okay? Father, we thank you for your goodness. Thank you for your truth and the beauty of the stories that come from your scripture. We pray that these truths would permeate our hearts and our souls today. Maybe, Father, there are those here whose world's been turned up down like Mephibosheth that day, or maybe they've had some bad news, or there's a relationship or a friend who's going through some really tough times. I don't know. And perhaps there are here people here this morning, Lord, that just need your assurance that in the midst of the trial, you're there, you're working things out. Father, there are so many different things that can happen, and I pray that even in the midst of these things there, where we don't understand all of your plans or your purposes, I pray that we would receive the peace that comes from you, that peace that surpasses all understanding, that in the midst of these trials, and these are trying times, that we'll see that you are working all things out for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purposes. Perhaps, God, there are those who have heard this beautiful story and it maybe stirred something inside of them, and they are right now wondering, could it be true? And I say, yes, your word is true, Father. And so, Lord, we begin to understand that we're fallen, we're broken, and the beautiful thing is we're pursued by you, King of Kings, King Jesus alone, that can bring forgiveness. And because of the sacrifice that you made on our behalf, and just as Mephibosheth could not do anything to earn David's favor and this blessing that David had given him, in the same way, there's nothing we can do to earn your goodness and forgiveness in our lives. You told us in Ephesians that even when we were still sinners, you, Christ, came and died for us. Oh God, may we understand that it's a free gift. You're pursuing us right now. The thing that's stirring on the inside of some hearts at this very moment is the feeling of, man, could this be true? This is for purpose. This need to feel forgiveness. This is for you, Father, King, pursuing us. And so, Lord, I pray for each one right now that we would say yes to you, Lord Jesus. And say yes, and as we do, your sacrifice covers our sin and makes us whole and makes us new. And there are those here this morning and online who just need to say yes right now to this relationship with you, to find forgiveness, to find purpose, to find meaning and truth, to find completeness and wholeness in the King who is pursuing them, that they can be made new. And those of us today who that's our decision, that you're here to, you know, and that you want to say yes to Jesus, come on in. We just ask you, Father, right now, come in, forgive my sins. Lord, give me this covering, the covering of your table. Heavenly Father, thank you for sending Jesus to die in my place. Even when I was broken, you sent him to be my sacrifice. And I receive your forgiveness. I believe your truth that I can be made new. I can be made whole. We can be made complete in you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And everybody says, amen. It's an emotional sermon for me this morning just to understand. The mercy and the graciousness of our God. Nothing I deserve, nothing you deserve. It's just that he, as I've preached the last 2 weeks, loves you so much. He loves you so much. With one word, he could have wiped out creation and restarted. No. Instead, he came to redeem creation and die in our place. When it came to this time in the Gospels, the disciples still didn't even understand it. I'm not sure as I live my little 3D life that I totally understand it now. Even Paul said, we just kind of see through a dark glass right now. It'll be more clear when we're in his presence. But Jesus tried to get the story out, and he met with the disciples that night, and it was the Passover. So it's a time when everybody went out to sacrifice lambs, and they were still waiting for this Messiah to be the lamb that would be the sacrifice for all time. And here he was. Here he was at the table with them. And just after that, he went down and he laid down his life for them and for all who had already gone before and for you who come now. It is only through the blood of Jesus Christ that your sins can be covered. Your brokenness, your fallenness can be covered. It is only through his body that you can sustain spiritually his broken and fragmented body. And so we're just going to simply do as he did with the disciples. It's a little bit different for us nowadays, but, and these things are tough. I've had a tough time handling them too, so they just have a little clear covering on top to get to the wafer, okay, before you take the foil off, or it can get messy, okay. So anyway, if you'd take that off, this little wafer, you know, in a way, it's not like the loaf of bread they had on that table or anything like that, but it's symbolic for us. And it represents that body of Jesus Christ. Precious Lamb of God. Who said, I'll let them rip me apart so that you can have life. To me, it's unbelievable. It's unbelievable. But he did that. And so he said, I'm going to give you this celebration. You do it again as many times as you need to remember what I've done for you. Would you do that? And so then he took the bread, and it says he broke the bread. His body was to be broken. And he said, take and eat and do so in remembrance of me. Would you do that now? You know, since the fall of Adam, there had never been perfection on this earth. Still hasn't, except for one. Since the fall, everything in creation has been marred by sin. But one came. Totally, no sin, no mar. Perfection. Finally, the blood that could be shed to cover the sin of all time. But as I told the guys at Tuesday morning at the men's breakfast, you know, we're coming on Christmas. You can put all the presents you want to under your tree. But unless someone reaches out and grabs that present and opens it up and uses it, it is meaningless to them. God has given you this present under your tree. Forgiveness of sins, the blood of Jesus Christ, the forgiveness of sins, and eternal life. People ask me all the time, why would a loving God send people to hell? I am here to tell you this morning, God will not send people to hell, but he will acknowledge your decision. You have a decision. He's laid the present in front of you. Will you accept or reject? It's the blood of Christ. He said, this is my blood shed for many for the remission totally gone of sin. Drink this as you do in remembrance of me. Let's drink together. My Lord, we thank you for the cup and for the blood, for the body that's been given for us. We thank you, Lord, for your great love for us. We thank you that our sins are covered by your table. We thank you, Lord, for this Sunday of hope. Of hope beyond the grave because of your sacrifice and your resurrection. Just an amazing story of your truth, grace, and mercy. And Lord, we give you all the praise and all the glory in the name of Christ. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Have a wonderful week.